right. Yes, we are super excited about that. I just need to go ahead and get something out of the way real quick. I'm a Falcons fan, and today the Falcons are playing a Super Bowl. So I wore a shirt, and someone harassed me and said, you're not supposed to wear a shirt. You know, you're not supposed to go ahead and get the NFC Championship. You got to wait and hold out for the Super Bowl because then, you know, you don't want to jinx it. I thought about putting a piece of tape over it. Listen, I'm not jinxing anything. Here's the deal, all right? Now, I'm a massive, huge Falcons fan. And this Super Bowl is definitely different. And people have asked about Super Bowl parties, like we should do something. And so we were talking about maybe doing something in the theater. They got construction going on. But I'm just completely honest with you. I normally just watch the Super Bowl for the commercials, right? I just want to watch and see which one, the Doritos ones, right? They're always the best. But this year is different, right? So like if you really wanted to have like a Super Bowl party, I'll give you a key to the church. You can come here and do whatever you want. We don't really even have cable, so I don't know how you're going to get on TVs, but you're welcome to come and watch, try to figure it out. But I want to be in my house. Like I want to watch the game. And so I'm super excited about it. I'm super excited about it. So here's the deal. Like, if you want to have a Super Bowl party, you can come to my house because we'll have plenty of food and I'll invite everybody. I invited everybody in the last service. You are welcome to come to my house, but there's going to be way more food than fellowship because I'm going to be watching the game. All right. And you try to have a conversation with me and be like, yeah, I hear it. Right. I get it. So I'm just putting it out there. Like, I'm super, super excited about the game today. I cannot wait. And I've talked about it way too much, and I've tried real hard not to have football analogies, but, you know, I wore a Falcons shirt. I mean, it's like, I'm just totally in my element, right? I'm so excited, right? It's so great. But as excited as I am about the Super Bowl, and as excited as I am, 18 years, I started watching football and following the Falcons 18 years ago, the last time they went to the Super Bowl. As excited as I am about today's game and about that, it doesn't even touch the excitement that I have for what is happening here with us as a church. And you saw what's happening in the video. We're maxed out in this space, and we've got to move. And we're taking out walls. We're doing everything we can to try to accommodate. But we are right now in the middle of the beginning of a journey to prepare us, to position us, to be able to get into a new space by this fall. And that's what the whole Bold Initiative is about. And we're not just going to go to a space and just have a church that meets there. We're not about just coming and sitting and being here on Sunday. This is a large part of it, but this is more about us gathering and worshiping together and encouraging one another. But we're really about between Sundays. What are we doing to prove God's love between Sundays? So you hear us talking about that. You see the cards in your seats. And it's a new thing for us. We've never done anything like this before, but it's time. So we have been going through the book of Nehemiah because as God has given us this grandiose vision and put us on this massive journey that's super exciting but also a little scary, we look at Nehemiah and we see a lot of comparisons. So we saw at the beginning where he recognized that the people of Israel were not in a good place. They were in danger, and they didn't have a wall to protect them. And building the wall was a part of restoring God's people, just as much as rebuilding the temple and restoring the religious culture. And so we have seen this vision to move to a bigger space and how to utilize and leverage that space as our wall, so to speak. And we're looking forward to what it is going to be. And so Nehemiah had this grand vision, this very bold vision to help ultimately restore and protect God's people. He put together a bold plan. He presented it to the Israelites, and all of them bought in. And we looked at that last week. We saw that everyone bought in. And then today, we're going to look at chapter 3 in Nehemiah. In fact, if you've got your Bibles, you can turn there right now. Use it on your phone, however you want to. You can borrow a Bible from us. You raise your hand, and one of our volunteers will be happy to bring you one. You can use it today. You can keep it if you want. It's a gift. But we're in the third chapter of Nehemiah, and we're going to see like what level they bought in. Like how did everyone buy in? Like what was the plan? Like they said, yes, we're ready to go. So they rose up to build, and they started to strengthen their hands to get ready for the project. And in chapter 3, we read about what everyone did. Now, before you read this, I need to tell you, this is one of those chapters. This is one of those chapters that you kind of wonder why they couldn't have just saved the ink, right, and the paper and just said, and they built a wall, period, all right? Because it's just a lot of names I cannot pronounce. It's this long list. It's grueling. It's grueling. And you know what we're going to do today? We're going to go through the whole thing. We're going to go from the top to the end because it's here for a reason, just as it is everywhere else in Scripture. When they have these lists and lists of names and so-and-so begat so-and-so or this person did this, the lists are there for a reason. There's something there that we need to learn. Something there that we need to understand. And so we want to try to pull out some truth, some application for us today. And so we're going to go through it. I got this little illustration to kind of help us through because this is a tough one, all right? So here we go. We're gonna dive right in. Chapter 3, starting in verse 1. If there's any scholars, anybody who knows how to pronounce these words better than me, which is probably everyone, please do not judge my mispronouncing these names. I may just call everybody Bob and Tim, all right, when we get to it, all right? So in chapter 3, all right, we're starting in verse 1, and we're going to see who did what in rebuilding the wall. So at the end of chapter 2, it says that all of them said they would rise up and build. They strengthened their hands for good work. Here we go in verse 1. Then Elisha, the high priest, rose up with his brothers and priests, and they built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and set its doors. They consecrated it as far as the Tower of the Hundred, as far as the Tower of Hananel. And next to him, the men of Jericho built. And next to them, Zakur, the son of Emery, built. The sons of Hasanei, he built the fish gate, all right? They worked on that. They laid its beams. They set its doors, its bolts, and its bars. Okay, we're just gonna have to fight through this because it's ridiculous. All right, here we go. I'm not trying to downplay the word of God. I'm just saying, like, if we sat here and read this thing, I know you guys would fall asleep. Okay, I would fall asleep. So we're just gonna fly through it. All right, here we go. So the Hasanea's sons built the fish gate, and then you've got Meremoth, and then Meshullam, who repaired some. You've got Zadok. You've got the Tekoites. They repaired some. Then there's Joiada. There's another Meshullam. He built the gate of Yeshana, the old gate. You have Gibeonites and the Maranathites. Oh, my goodness. They repaired some. Uzel, and all the goldsmiths, right? He led the goldsmiths. They repaired some. You have another, or Hananiah, who's and the perfumers, right, who got together, they repaired some. I don't really know how to pronounce this. Rep. We'll call him Rep, all right? He was a district ruler. He repaired some. Jedea repaired opposite of his house. You've got Hattush. You've got Machijah. You've got Hashub. They repaired a section to the Tower of the Ovens. Shalom, a district ruler. He repaired with his daughters, which is fascinating too, because you would not normally include women in this list, and so this just speaks to his level of buy-in, their level of buy-in. Then you have Hanun, all right, and the inhabitants of Zanoah, they repaired the valley gate and 1,000 cubits of the wall. They completed a ton of it, and they went all the way to as far as the dung gate. They would not, it's like, I'm going to build a lot, but I'm not touching the garbage, all right? So he did not go to the dung gate. You've got Malkishah repaired the dung gate. Another Shalom, a district ruler, repaired the fountain gate, built wall around the pool of Shalah, the king's garden. You've got a different Nehemiah who repaired some, the Levites. And the Levites, so this priestly order, there were several, and they built several different individuals and groups and families who built right outside their house in their backyard, several of them. And then you've got Ophel, who repaired the water gate and a good portion of the wall, and some more Tekoites who repaired all the way to the horse gate and the horse gate. And then you have the priests who got and repaired this little spot right outside where they live, opposite of their house. You've got Zadok repaired opposite his house, and Shemaiah repaired the east gate. Another Hananiah and Hanun repaired another section of the wall. There's another Meshullam who repaired opposite of his chamber. Malkijah repaired all the way past the muster gate. And then the merchants repaired the last little portion, and the whole wall was completed. That's chapter 3. Now, why? And you're like, oh my goodness, right? Why is that important? Why is it important, all these different names? Well, the names are there for specific record to show who did what, what family, what tribe, what group did what, how much they did. And in fact, you can look at archaeological discovery and see how these sections were built independent of each other. You can look and see that this is really a historical record. It's not just a list for fun. There's actually a lot of truth here. You can dig into the names and the families and who represented who, why they built, where they built. All that stuff's important. But for today, I just want to pull out a few truths, a few general truths. And the first thing that stood out to me reading that list and looking at it was a phrase that recurred over and over again. They built outside their house, near their house, opposite their house, right outside their chamber. What does that mean? It means that the portion of the wall that a lot of these groups and families chose to rebuild was just the part outside their house. It was the part that was at the back of their yard. And I was thinking about a contemporary example. I was thinking about, like, okay, well, how can we bring that into a modern context? Help us understand why someone would look at just the wall in their backyard or just that small portion. And the thing that came to mind was HOAs, right? Homeowner associations. All right. Now I don't have a homeowner association anymore. I did for a long time, and we had a lot of issues, a lot of run-ins, a lot of letters in our mailbox from the HOA, which is one of the reasons why we moved somewhere else. But the irony is, I actually really like neighborhoods with the HOA. I totally get why you would have a neighborhood with an HOA, because you come into a neighborhood and all the yards are manicured and all the bushes are trimmed and everything looks nice and uniform and it's very collective. You drive in, you're like, this is a nice neighborhood. As opposed to some, you go, oh wow, this place let itself go. You know, they don't have an HOA. You know, you've been there, you've been some places. Well, the thing is, like, when you have an HOA and you've got this uniform and everyone's like, look, this, the value of our property matters, right? We've made an investment here and we're all in this together. So let's work on what we can work on so that we can keep the property value up, right? So we can get a better return on our investment. And they know that if Joe Schmo down the street, which, by the way, that was me. I was the guy with the weeds in his yard, the bushes are overgrown, and there was an empty lot next to us, like we parked our camper. So I broke lots of rules, right? Lots of rules. And so I got lots of letters. And it was funny too, because there was an elderly couple, very sweet couple, lived a couple doors down, and they're very nice, loved our kids, and they were really, really great. They moved away, and all of a sudden the letter stopped. It was crazy. So I think they just called us. Every time we did something wrong, they called us out. But the HOA, the basic function of an HOA is really simple, right? We know that if we can just band together and take care of what we should take care of, which is our own yard, what's right in front of us, then we can help each other out. It'll elevate our property value. It will make the neighborhood more attractive. It will benefit all of us in the long run. And all you have to do is just take care of your own yard. That's all you got to do. Just take care of your own yard. Now, I love that idea. I thought it was great. I just didn't take care of my own yard, all right? Or I was lazy, or I didn't get it done, or whatever, right? And I didn't even have a large yard. Good gracious, the yard I have now. Oh my goodness. Okay, so I think about the HOA, and I understand the principle behind it. I understand that if you're like me and you live in you like HOA neighborhoods, or if you want to live in a neighborhood like that because you like the uniformness, or you know that it increases the value, then you get and understand when, you know, Joe Schmo down the street, somebody hasn't lived in the house for 2 years, had a for sale sign in the yard, and it looks like a haunted house now because it's all overgrown and disgusting, and somebody just doesn't care. Like, it bothers you, and you pass it, and you know that people pass it, they think things, everybody makes assumptions. And so if you're really trying to make the neighborhood the best it can be, you want everybody on board. And you want everybody to buy into the big vision, which is, look, we can all benefit each other. It's a win-win if we just take care of our own yard, if we just take care of the one thing that's just right in front of us, if we just take care of the portion of the wall right outside our house, which is exactly what they did. They made the portion personal. They said, this is what I can do. I'm not skilled masonry. I'm not great. I don't own a landscape company. I can't mow everyone's yard, which is like the perfect scenario for me. It's to live in a neighborhood where somebody just mows everyone's yard, takes care of everything. Awesome, right? That'd be awesome. But here, it's here's this space right outside my house. Nobody else is going to take care of it. It's on me. So if I care about everybody else, and if I am really a part of this team, if I am buying into this unified effort, then the least I can do is take care of my own yard. The least I can do is build the wall right outside my house and make that portion personal and say, this is my responsibility. This is what I'm going to take care of. And that's what so many of them did. But here's what else is when you look at it and you see that it was very personal. And we saw that everyone bought in. We saw it in chapter 2. We saw, and that's what we talked about last week. Everyone bought in. And we pray that everyone here will buy in as well. But the buy-in was not equal, right? The portion, the sweat equity was not the same. So even if their portion was personal, there was no expectation that everyone did the same amount of work. It was just that everyone did some work. Everyone did something. And so the portion was not equal, but the expectation was equal. The portion was personal, but the expectation was equal, not the portion. In fact, if you look at it, you see the blue sliver over there. This one guy and the people that he had built almost 20% of the entire wall. Now, it's not to scale, but you can see that it's a good portion. And there's others that built large portions as well because they had the skill, because they had the people, because they had the resources. And then you look down in this one corner where the Levites built, and they had several other people, several other families that built just right outside their house, and you see all those little colors. And you have, see, you don't get, when you read this passage, when you read this chapter, you don't see that. You just, somebody did something, somebody else did something. You don't really grasp it. That's just the reason why I put this map up there and did the colors with the little doodle pen on the computer so that you could see that there are some who gave a ton and some who gave a lot less. But all together, the wall was completed. Now, the other portion I want you to look at is right up here, kind of on the top. There's a little green right in the corner up there. That was the priests. And the priests, they're not builders. The priests, they're not, they don't have the skills, right? And we saw that there were goldsmiths. We saw there were perfumers. We saw there were merchants. We saw there were leaders of districts, right? So everyone was involved. Everyone was involved. And the priests, right, they usually kind of live off the land. People give them resources. They're the ones that are teaching. They're the ones that are encouraging. They're the ones who are the scholars of the law, who are helping maintain the religious culture. And the priests aren't necessarily the ones who get their hands dirty. They're the ones who get involved. But in this story here, they're like, no, everyone. So priests, you're not good at laying bricks. That's fine. That's fine. We'll help you. But you got to do something. So can you all just come together and just do that time? Can you just do a tiny little section? Can you just focus on this one little piece? All right? Just focus on this one little piece. And they did. And so on one side of the city, you've got one dude and his people and his resources, and he's got tons of money. He's got tons of people. He's got skill. And he knocks it out and helps in other places. It's awesome. And then you've got the priests who are, it's like, we're not really good at this. Okay. But this is a unified effort, right? So can you do this? And they did. And because everyone came together and because everyone saw that the expectation was equal, everyone did whatever they could. And I think it's important for us to recognize and see that as we're talking about our bold initiative, we're talking about making a move, you know, this fall and preparing ourselves to be in the right kind of position where we can do this and open our doors between Sundays and connect with more people and ultimately connect them to God and help fulfill our mission more than ever before, that it has to be this unified effort. But no one needs to assume that they have to give like someone else gives. Because there will be people here who give and have already, people who have promised to take care of large portions of the wall. But no one should assume that they have no, that there's no expectation for them to give anything. I think all of us, me included, and I told you guys last week what my buy-in was, that we've all got to decide, what are we going to do? At least something. Why? Why do we expect everyone to be involved? Why do we not just Why do we not just say, man, just the really wealthy people, let's just go find some outside investors. Let's just talk to the people who make the most money or have the best skills, the most resources. Let's just let them handle it. And all the people who are really struggling, you know, month to month to pay bills, we shouldn't ask them to get involved. No. Because here, when you read this list, the other reason you have it listed here, when it says that everyone bought in, you read the families, you get the checks, like, yeah, everyone bought in. Because if they're looking at this list and they're saying, man, this is everybody. Everybody did something. Their portion was personal, but it wasn't equal. The expectation was equal, but they didn't all give the same. So why did they do it? Because the ultimate objective was ownership, was a unified front. The restoration of God's people, that they would come together around a common purpose and a common goal. And we have a mission that we've seen God do amazing things over the last few years. And we expect God to do massive things going forward. But we want everyone to be on board. We want everyone to have ownership. We want everyone to at least own the wall outside their house. To at least say, you know what, I can be responsible for this, whatever that is. And you know that it might be very small, and you might have to work with others to try to figure out what can actually be done. But if everyone, 100%, not 1%, not the wealthy 1% that takes care of everything, but 100% has some level of ownership, has some level of buy-in, has some way to say, I was a part of this. Then every story we tell, every project we're a part of, everything that we do, you get to say, you get to celebrate with us. Listen, I say this all the time, but I just want to hammer this point for just a second. When we do food drives, when we collect school supplies, when we go serve in the community, when we do community baby showers, when we all the things that we have going on, right? And we stand up here and we talk about the families that were fed, or we talk about the schools that were helped, or we talk about the new and expectant moms in need that were overwhelmed by the gifts, okay? And we do all the things that we've got going on, right? The people who serve at this and serve at that. And we're not expecting everybody to be at everything or to give at everything. But as we're sharing those stories, right, here's the question. If you've never given anything, if your contribution to what Oak Leaf Church is, if your investment is just filling a seat on Sunday, what ownership is that to the bigger story? What real level of buy-in is that to just come and sit? Because we're not a church that's about just Sunday. This is important to us. It's very important to us. We come, we respond to God's love together. Very important to us. But this is a refueling, right? It's a re-energizing. It's a celebration of what God has done in the past week and a refueling. So we're ready to do be a part of what God's doing the week to come. And then we come and do it again every week. Because we need that. We need to come together and we need to worship. But if this is all you get from Oak Leaf, if this is all you have, this is your whole experience, then you're coming and just watching other people build the wall. You're watching other people take ownership in their backyard, because this church is not about just coming and sitting here on Sunday. This church is about what we do between Sundays. Proving God's love is yes, we're going to prove God's love like we talked about today earlier. We'll prove God's love to each other, absolutely, because it's an overflow of us wanting to fulfill that mission. But at the end of the day, that you guys are here, we want to continue to prop that up, but God has called us out. It's not about a building. It's not about a cool idea in the building. It's about the people that we meet, the relationships that are made, the opportunities to prove God's love to someone new. And that's the ultimate reason why we have to move, because if we want to continue to fulfill our mission, we're out of space. We got to create more room, because we're going to meet more people. We're going to see more marriages restored. We're going to see more addictions overcome. We're going to see more forgiveness given and relationships brought back together. We're going to see more lives changed by the gospel and more people publicly declare their allegiance to Christ through baptism. We're going to see more of that stuff. But ownership comes from bold unity. It comes from us realizing that when everybody invests, it leads to success. Our success is the fulfillment of that mission. When everyone invests, it helps lead us to success. It helps lead us to where God wants us to be. And when we share these stories and when we talk about what God is doing, we all get to celebrate. And you get to be a part of it and say, man, you know what? I only donated a can of peas because that's all I could give. But you gave. And you're as much a part of the story as the guy who gave 1,000 can of peas. You understand? But if you've never given a can of peas, if you've never given a spiral notebook, if you've never given a penny, where's your ownership? So here, we look at this list. Listen to me. We look at this list and we read these names and we see what they did and we know that some did a ton and some only did a little, and it doesn't matter because at the end of the day, the wall's completed. Because portions didn't sit and say, I can't do it, and that whole section of the wall never got done because they just expected somebody else to do it for them. It didn't happen here, and it can't happen with us. See, we need everyone to buy in. So we have our own list. So that when when people are looking back, because we know that this whole wall, right, they're rebuilding this wall. This is not the end of the story. Rebuilding the temple was not the end of the story. Restoring the religious culture was not the end of the story. Rebuilding the wall is not the end of the story. All of this is a preparation for Jesus to come and say that, hey, this temple is going to be destroyed. God is not confined to four walls. It's bigger than that. This is setting the stage for something much, much bigger. And we know that what we're doing is setting the stage for something much, much bigger. So whatever that is, for people to look back and look at the list and say, man, look at how this church bought in. So-and-so painted the wall, and so-and-so fixed a chair, and so-and-so built walls, and so-and-so did all the plumbing, and so-and-so did this, and so-and-so. And you look at the same kind of list, and they go, man, how did this church do that? Here, look what they did. Everybody bought in. Why did they do that? Man, because they made it personal. They saw a portion and said, man, I'm going to take care of my backyard. They saw that the expectation was equal, even though the portion was not. And when those that gave a little got to celebrate just as much as those that gave a lot. Because what you give doesn't matter. It's that you give. It's that you say, I'm in. I'm ready. Let's do this. I get it. This is where God has called me to. This is the home church that God has brought me to. This is the mission I'm buying into. I'm excited about what's coming. I'm excited about being a part of this. I mean, you look back and say, man, look at what God has done with me, my family, through this church, through the ministry of this church, or just excited about a hope of what's going to happen. And you say, I'm in and ready to go. And your name gets on the list. So we've been talking about this for a couple weeks, and we got a couple more weeks to go. But the whole point of this is to really emphasize that we can't rely on just a few. We can't rely just on me. This is a team effort. This is all coming together. This is bold unity. This is knowing that when everyone invests, it leads to success. So on February 26th, right, you got these cards. You can see these cards. Some of you already have them. That's fine. They're on the chair. It tells you basic summary of what we're doing. But on February 26th, we're going to ask everyone to make a commitment. We're not asking for money. We're not asking everybody to give anything today. We're just saying, hey, would you commit to pray? Would you commit? Would you begin to pray about what your level of ownership is? Would you begin to kind of ask those questions? You know, if you get that the expectation is not equal, and you do want to take care of the portion right outside your house, so make it personal, and you're ready to dive in and have ownership, what does it look like for you? What does it look like for you? When everyone invests, it leads to success. And we know that if we truly want to succeed, if we truly want to reach 240,000, even just a fraction of the 240,000 people within 15 miles of our front door, if we truly want to prove God's love to this community, see the gospel change the culture around us, then we need everybody on the wall. We need everyone to invest because it'll lead to success. Now, this is the stereotypical time when the pastor closes the Bible and everybody knows he's about to wrap up, right? So the band's going to come up. We're gonna sing a song. We're going to close out today. But here are the questions that I want you just to kind of think about. Will you unite with us around this common goal? Will you be a part of this? You don't have to answer the question today. I just want you to pray about it. I want you to to begin the process of saying, God, is this where you would have me? And if he says yes, if this is where you believe God wants you to land and call home, is it time for you to rise up and build, to strengthen your hands for work, to say yes? Is it time for you to make it personal and say, I'm going to take care of the portion outside my house? And maybe for some of you, that portion's gigantic. And for some of you, it's really small. But hopefully you'll realize that the portion doesn't matter. Just the expectation that all of us are in. Would you commit to take ownership on our cause, to buy in with us and unite? I pray you will. And as we've got a couple more weeks and we're praying through this, we've already seen God do amazing things. And I mean, I'm just, oh my goodness, I can't wait. Today's a massive, huge, awesome day. And I can't wait to sit and eat wings and watch the game and ignore everybody else in the house so I can just focus on play, you know, every snap. But my excitement for a silly football game is nothing compared to my excitement for what God's about to do, for what he's already done. As I'm having conversations in the community, talking about this, about the need for space to be used, for people just to come and hang out, and I'm like, oh my goodness, if just a portion of the people who are talking about being excited would come and sit and interact, every conversation, every connection, all those relationships that can be built, I mean, it just blows my mind at the possibilities. Blows my mind at the sheer number of people that we can connect with. Because it's not, like, we still want to invite people to church on Sunday. We still want to continue to grow. That's why we need more space. But at the end of the day, there's a ton of people, tens of thousands of people who need God's love proven to them. And we need to position ourselves to be in front of them so we can do it. To not just expect them to show up on Sunday, but to give them a place that they want to come and be loved on. We can do it. I can't wait. Father, this morning, looking at something from 2,500 years ago, but seeing how you brought your people together, unified them around the common purpose, the common goal. You've given us that. You've given us the mission. You've given us this bold vision. And oh my goodness, I'm just so excited about it. But Father, at the end of the day, it's not a one-man mission. It's not just a few leaders' mission. It's the whole church's mission. And I pray that as we draw closer to the big day where we learn who's in, that you will move in the hearts of the people starting today to make their portion personal, to accept the expectation it's equal, and to have ownership on this great cause. Help us be unified, Father, around you, so that more people are changed by the gospel. More people see the proof of your love. And we pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen.